In fact, the wastewater that would be coming out from beneath these systems, although it would still be adequately treated, the wetlands would provide additional sources of nutrient removal from the wastewater prior to entering groundwater.
Thank you. Okay, I think I've exhausted my list of questions. Any other board members? Any additional questions? Anyone wish to give a motion on the wetland alteration permit portion of the application?
Mr. Chair?
You want us to do them both?
I have.
Let me restate my question. The planner is suggesting that it's appropriate that we make one motion and deal with both applications at the same time. I guess that's certainly appropriate. So with that, why don't we move ahead then to the public access portion of the review and ask if anyone has any specific questions with respect. Again, this is not public access portion is not a public hearing, but questions that were raised earlier certainly can be considered. Any questions or comments?
I have a question, Mr. Chair.
Yes, Roy.
I'm a little confused because of the back to the boundary line again, in that there are really four parties involved in this boundary line. In effect, the Whitakers have given possibly an easement to the land trust if that line happens to be where they claim. So we have a problem there. If the line is not as we see it tonight, what we're doing right now will have to be redone because we have a whole new lineup of where that road goes through and access. We also have a change in what the radius will be for the access. So it seems to me that before we can really, can we vote on say that let's assume that what's been submitted by the applicant is in fact the property line and we act on that basis?
I'm not sure that the easement is affected. The easement is on the property.
I only bring that up
on the side of the Whitaker's line, and if that's in the middle of the abutting property, the easement would still be on the west side of that line.
I only bring that up to indicate that there is something that needs to be solved before we can vote, at least the way I look at it, unless we vote based on what the applicant has submitted.
That's the way we'd normally vote. I mean, we only vote on what the applicant has submitted. If there's anything that's either not legal about the application or incomplete with respect to the board's knowledge of what it was voting on.
Then are we to make a judgment that that line is correct?
I'm not going to make a judgment one way or the other. I don't know about the other board members, but I'm not going to state whether it's correct or not correct. I think I can state that I would accept the information that's before us and vote on it, but I'm not going to state that the information is correct or not correct. I don't think we know that with any application any more than the information that's before us. We have a set of deeds and we have the surveyor's boundary survey and a signed survey. I guess what I would offer to the applicant is that if the board were to go ahead and vote on this and approve it, that I would fully expect that the abutters would contest the vote and that what we could end up with is a fairly lengthy and expensive resolution to this issue. I think it would perhaps be appropriate, as discussed earlier, that perhaps we table this and allow the two abutters to meet and try to resolve this in a reasonable way. And if at the end of a reasonable period they're unable to do that, then the applicant can certainly come back before the board with its case, and the board could proceed on that basis.
I strongly urge that as an appropriate method of dealing at this point.
All right. Why don't we take that into consideration when the motion's made. I would still like to, if there are any further questions with respect to the public access waiver portion of the application, ask if the board has any questions of the applicant.
Well, Mr. Chair, I do have some serious concerns about the minimal 8-foot boundary on the eastern side of this lot, but it doesn't make an awful lot of sense to me to get into that without knowing what the resolution of the boundary issue is. I can express my concern and simply let it go at that.
Would it be appropriate to say or describe the situation that regardless of where the boundary line is, that the buffer remains a constant issue? I mean, unless this thing is 30 feet into the property line, but assuming that it's not too far off, that there still is a requirement for buffering between the boundary line and the roadway.
Yes.
Ms. Wilcox.
I would like to express a concern that I've gone through the requirements in the ordinance for public access waiver and for wetlands alteration permit, and unlike the site plan review section of our ordinance, it does not mention buffering.
Mm-hmm.
It mentions buffering between the wetland and adjacent uses, but not between two single-family homes trying to build next to each other.
That's right.
Mm.
I guess what I would set forth in terms of my concerns about this is the public access waiver, I will state one more time, as a planning board chair, I think is a lousy way to do planning in the town of Cape Elizabeth, but it's the most powerful planning tool that we have, and that at some point both the board and the council is going to have to come up with standards if there's anything left to apply for a public access waiver on. But I think what happens is that the public access waiver, because of the development in Cape Elizabeth as it currently exists, often means that their butters are affected by development that one wouldn't otherwise see. That is, that houses get tucked behind houses, they get placed in a higher density than one might have otherwise expected. So with respect to that concern, I don't pause for a minute if an abutter has raised a concern about privacy, about impact on their property, that it's a reasonable mitigation of that to suggest that some sort of a buffer might be appropriate. And certainly the abutter also has the opportunity to add anything to that that the abutter may wish to do. But unfortunately, in development and planning and everything else, the last person in is usually the one that has to rectify issues that may have been pre-existing the development. I guess that's the basis for which I would suggest that it would be beneficial to have twice the number of trees that are currently proposed. With respect to, again, the public access waiver, is it clear to the planning board as to where the right-of-way to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust lies, and is it reasonable to expect that 10 people walking Land Trust property can march down this driveway in 2 years and not have somebody in one of the houses complaining about impacts because they're going down the driveway? There's not a separate identifiable trail that marks that. And I don't think that trail can be accommodated in an 8-foot wide patch of grass that's going to have a buffer in it, and that buffer will mature to at least a 10-foot width if it's allowed to do so. And I know the applicant, I won't speak for the applicant, but what the applicant is trying to do here is fit as much as the applicant can with the minimum amount of impact on the wetlands. I, as one board member, wouldn't mind seeing the road shift a couple more feet to provide adequate buffering and adequate access for the land trust.
I agree with you.
The other question I had with respect to the back house lot is that the turnaround apron is 16 feet in one dimension and 24 in the other, and the 24 is facing the garage. Is there any reason why it's wider facing the garage and then starts off with a narrower driveway?
Yes, I think I can answer that. I understand that the fire truck has some requirements for radiuses and areas if they need to turn around, and that 24 feet was generated to provide emergency vehicle access.
Did you have any discussion with the fire chief as to accommodating some of that in a gravel shoulder that might have loam and seat over it?
I know that I haven't personally spoken with the fire chief, but I think he's looked at the plan, and Joel's actually spoken. Have you spoken with the fire chief? So I don't know the answer to that. I don't know. I know that we have a portion of the roadway as gravel with loam and seed over it. But as far as the turnaround area, I suspect that if an emergency vehicle is trying to turn around, the wheel movements ends up being the most disruptive when they're actually turning. Mm-hmm. So if there was loam and seed, I would assume that there'd be more of an opportunity for disturbance in that scenario, but...
So if we pave it, there won't be any fire, and if it isn't paved, there will be an emergency?
That's probably right.
The extra width, it's the 1-foot shoulder that's identified on the plan?
Yes.
That you're talking to?
I think we needed to have 18 feet, so there's a 1 foot on either side.
Any other questions or comments with respect to the public access waiver? As part of the public access waiver, I think what I would ask you do again is to provide setbacks to the house, to the building envelope. And to the nearest point of the house measured perpendicular from the property line. I think that's for everyone's best interest. If you get in the field and suddenly this thing isn't where we all expected it to be, you'll know right away. If an abutter, for any reason, gets involved in the process, it'll be helpful to the code enforcement officer. And I think it's good insurance for the applicant. The other question I had was with respect to the overhead power alignment. The overhead power is on a power pole across Scott Dyer Road, and it heads sort of diagonally along the length of the driveway and is located behind the first house and then splits in two directions. It seems to me as though there's quite an impact of having that going diagonally across the driveway. So when you, for all the hard work that goes into trying to nestle the houses behind the trees and between the wetlands, all of a sudden you go down and you see this power line going diagonally down the length of the driveway to a power pole. Is there any consideration to placing a power pole someplace else closer to Scott Dyer Road and going back from there, or even providing underground primary service or secondary service?
The power pole, actually what we were, the line, the location that we are proposing for the power pole is, there's an existing pole across the Scott Dyer Road, and we were proposing to set a new pole to run it in because of the distance. CMP will require an intermediate pole. It seemed to work well with running one pole into this location. As far as, I suppose there could be an offset pole put over on this location and run down to here, and I would anticipate that any cost for that would have to be borne by the applicant. I mean, he's going to have to pay for the electric anyway. As far as underground electric, Joel and I have discussed that. I think we discussed it at the last planning board meeting, and frankly, it was seemed like a very expensive option, and we were trying to assess whether it was required by ordinance to go underground or whether we could have the option to remain overhead, and because of cost.
Is it unreasonable to anticipate that perhaps someone who would be looking to purchase a parcel of land that's as large as the one that's tucked behind the front lot and with an opportunity to build a fairly sizable house, that person would also be looking for underground utilities as part of their package, so to speak? I mean, we have a realtor on the board. I asked Joel. Go ahead.
I have the hopes that the person that does buy this package will agree to put underground utilities from one pole. That would be my recommendation to the person that comes along. I would like to give them the option, but I do agree that having power lines going back to this the back lot aesthetically wouldn't be pleasing. So I am going to try my best to.
Can you actually span that long a distance on a house surface? Well, that's like 160 feet or so, I think.
Generally, they don't like to go over 200 feet.
200.
Okay. It's a guideline that's always been long to me.
Again, I think for the benefit of being granted a public access waiver, or for having gone through the arduous process of having the planning board review a public access waiver, it would seem certainly a concern that this power, this overhead power line is going right down the length of the driveway, and I would ask that it be moved from one side or the other. It's clear to me that if you move it to the side nearest the abutter, you are obviously having an impact there, but I'm not sure that impact doesn't exist with it going diagonally down the driveway, too.
And I guess I would also like to really see some underground utility consideration given, because it seems to me if somebody, if you are serious about marketing the back lot as a potential underground utility, that a lot of the beauty of that would be undercut by having overhead utilities on the first lot. That's the entrance lot, so.
Yes, I agree.
Not sure how that gets tied into the motion, but I think something should be done to deal with the alignment of the overhead electric, if nothing else, to get it to one side of the road or the other.
I'm understanding Joel is still wanting to run overhead to here, but you're switch to underground from this pole, make that a requirement of this house sale, or you still want to leave the option?
If it would help the board to approve, that I will, the way I would like to see that is to have underground on both properties, you know, but the further we go, the more this is costing, the higher the packages. It just depends how far this goes. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to keep these two packages somewhat, you know, affordable. Mm-hmm. The average person.
Yep.
Certainly at the minimum we could work with CMP, because they'll actually be the ones that install the pole. Joel will have to pay for it, but they're the ones that install it. Can work with them in the planning to, I think the power is going to have to come from pole 23, but we could bring it into the site and run it along this side of the property line. I would prefer not to run it along the Whitaker side. I think that would be.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? I have a motion. Janet?
That the matter be tabled until the next meeting, the next regularly scheduled meeting in August.
For both applications?
Mm-hmm.
I have a motion. I have a second.
Second.
Any discussion? I guess what I'd like to do with that motion then is without, I don't think the planning board's in any position to make promises to an applicant, but if there are any further concerns that the planning board has with respect to the application and anything that the board members would like to see addressed on the plan, I think we should advise the applicant of that. Mark?
One that comes to my mind immediately, you, Mr. Chairman, mentioned the possibility of a graveled shoulder as a way of improving the amount of site impact on the turnaround here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if the fire chief has ever looked at that type of an alternative for a main entrance to a site, but at this point, because of those radiuses, there's about a 65-foot width of street opening.
Mm-hmm.
At this point.
At Scott Dyer Road or at the driveway?
At Scott Dyer Road, which mm-hmm. is more of a shopping center type of entrance as opposed to single family residential mm-hmm. type of curb cut.
Maureen?
We don't have curbs there, but still that's a wide open.
Having discussed this exact issue with the fire chief many times, the answer I'm usually given is that even if it were gravel, his concern is that while you may be able to get in there and get out during the good weather, when it starts to snow, people only plow the gravel part of the driveway. And then he ends up with 12-foot wide widths, and he can't move his equipment around. And so that's the answer I usually get about why we don't want to do a lot of loading and seating.
I guess I will support Mark's concern there. Going down, if you want an example, all you have to do is look at the other side of the Scott Dyer Road on the same plan and look at the driveway opening that's on the other side of the road. That's for one house. What we're talking about is a second house. It's And I guess the other question I would have, if a 20-foot radius is adequate on the acute angle side of the driveway, then certainly on the obtuse angle side, where the maneuvering is presumably a little easier, that the 20-foot radius would be adequate on that side as well.
It's not the turn going Scuppscott Tire this way. What we were concerned about is the truck's going to be coming out at an angle like this, and if he needs to make that right-hand turn, he ends up having to make a wider swing, because he's already pointed this way, but he really wants to go this way. And frankly, when we put the turning templates to it, it was very, very tight. And in talking with Maureen, I get the impression that the fire chief can't get his truck around there. He's very upset.
But the last little triangular piece that's created by that 30-foot radius that creates that very wide break in Scott Dyer Road isn't going to, you know, if the fire truck swings over to the left along that radius, it's not going to then be able to swing back and make an extremely acute right turn there. I just don't see where the additional radius on that side is gaining much other than to increase the curb opening.
Well, one thing, maybe what we could do is extend the tangent here, or maybe widen this throat a little bit, extend the tangent and neck the radius back down when we get closer to the road. But I would really like to have some width up there, because it's very, very tight when you put a turning template to it.
And I, with all due deference to the fire chief and all due deference to our volunteer department, which does an incredible job, if a fire truck were exiting that driveway and had to make a couple of maneuvers to get onto Scott Dyer Road, I don't know if that's the worst situation in the case of an emergency that's, with reasonable construction and everything else, should be a fairly infrequent event. I mean, we've all seen what happened down at the intersection of Broadway and Route 77 when we get all the engineered radiuses we could ever use and then some. The other way this may be resolved, I can't remember if there's a gravel shoulder there or whether it's all grass, but sometimes by utilizing the gravel shoulder as part of the turning radius, the paved width can be narrowed somewhat.
There isn't much of a shoulder on the Scott Dyer Road. If you drive down that side, it's very deep. There might be a foot or a foot and a half along this frontage here. I know that I've tried to get my vehicle off the road and park out there, and it's very tight. I think that's what you're referring to, the gravel shoulder down along. What I'm asking is if the fire chief, we can neck this down and make it so that it's less impact, you know, it has less of an opening. But it goes back to exactly what you said, Tom. It may be that the fire truck would have to do a couple of maneuvers to make that right-hand turn. And I'm indifferent to that as long as...
I guess the most that we can ask is that you revisit the issue with the fire chief and ask specifically if this can be a combination of use of gravel base and then some paved area that, and again, I think this gets back to the whole issue of the wetland alteration permit. It may be nice not to alter a wetland, but also the more one creates impervious surfaces unnecessarily for Easter Sunday, so to speak. I really don't like planning for the worst eventual catastrophe that one could ever imagine when it may occur very infrequently. And again, that's with all due respect and deference to the fire chief and to the department. The board takes their comments very seriously, but there's a lot of literature out regarding loading of fire vehicles on ways other than just on asphalt. And if the issue is maintenance, it certainly can be part of the maintenance requirement that the full width of the gravel shoulder and the paved areas be maintained for access. Ms. McKay.
So on a slightly different note, I'd just like to emphasize something that I said before, and I don't know whether or how strongly other board members feel about this, but I really, for one person anyway, would like very much to see the applicant explore increasing the buffer perhaps to 10 feet rather than 8, and then sketching out the easement for the land trust next to that, not having it be the land trust imposed over the buffering strip, and then having the driveway set on next to that, trying to, again, I mean, I understand what you're trying to do in terms of minimizing the impact on the wetland, but I don't think we need to do that to the exclusion of laying out the project properly. So I don't know how strongly other people feel about that, but I certainly do.
I think if the board is going to grant a wetland alteration permit, and based on the report of the quality of the wetland, that the minor reconfiguration of the road and shifting of the road is going to have a net benefit to the environmental impact of the project on both the wetland and the adjacent neighborhood, and in preservation of the rural character of Cape Elizabeth, which is ranks very high in the comprehensive plan. That's my opinion. Anyone else?
Tom, I'm confused. I'm just trying to understand the comments so that we can address this. This 15-foot easement, as I understand it, is dedicated along that property line. So if we shifted the road over, I can't move the easement over, I don't think, because the easement is dedicated, at least.
I'm suggesting that the roadway be separate from the easement, not superimposed. That the easement exists, and then that that is a pedestrian way, and then that the roadway to the two lots would be a separate.
I was thinking that, you know, the easement was moving with it, but okay.
And how are you envisioning that the board would gain knowledge of the impact of that? Are you looking for a full application, or it sounds almost like that's a sort of a back to a workshop type situation, because that's a fairly significant shift in the plan that we have here. I'm not disagreeing with your suggestion. It seems like the cleanest way to keep that easement issue clear and to have minimum impact, both in terms of concerns about maintenance on the driveway, as well as the public not having to worry about impacting the two house owners. It certainly has a significant impact on the it shifts everything, if I'm not mistaken, about 15 feet. So it would have some significant impact in the total area of wetland that would be disturbed, and it would probably shift the buildings an additional 15 feet as well. Everything would just move as a, it wouldn't affect the building in the back lot, but it would affect the building in the front lot a little bit.
If I recall properly, I think I mentioned this at the workshop and also mentioned it at the site plans walk, in the site walk. So I don't know whether the applicant has given that consideration and decided against it or not, but perhaps there could be two alternative proposals next time, one that moves it back the 15 feet and the other is something else, but I don't know.
Go ahead.
I remember you commenting on that, okay, and we are going for wetlands permit, so common sense told me that don't touch the wetlands. Another thing about the easement, when I talked with the land trust people, they gave me the feeling that they were happy to see this opened up, because right now you couldn't get through there with a chainsaw. The abutting neighbors have a no trespassing sign right beside the line, so no one can walk down this way beside the line. They've got to go through the easement, which is impossible to get through right now. The land trust was happy to see this happen. They like the idea of the signs, because now people can get back there, you know, once this happens. Right now they can't, without a chainsaw or a weed whacker or something. That was the reason for, back to your comment, was my whole thing was we got to keep out of the wetlands.
We have differing, I mean, obviously we're trying to balance a lot of different things here, and I do appreciate your concern about the wetlands. We're all concerned about that. I guess my sense is that I don't want to, that people don't like to walk down other people's driveways, even when there's an arrow that says, you know, go in this direction, and I for one would like not to have to encourage them to do that. So I'd like to suggest that since we are doing the land trust a favor, or you are, by opening that up, that we have a clearly delineated path. path so that they, the pedestrians can walk down something other than someone else's driveway.
We do have this, 8 feet here. There are trees that are going to be blocking that. So it's hard because we're trying to please a lot of different people here.
How do the other board members feel strongly about that issue?
Well, I think as a practical matter, I don't, who is going to maintain that walkway so they can, don't have to go on these people's driveways? I don't imagine they're going to go in and mow that and keep it clean and so forth and so on to keep people off the driveways. So as a practical matter, the driveway really should be as close and overlap the right-of-way as much as possible.
Mr. Chair.
That way it'll be kept clear and it'll keep people in the right-of-way where they're supposed to be to walk to the back then.
Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Wilcox.
We may not have all had a chance to read it, but the correspondence from the Conservation Commission,
right,
which we received this evening, recommended that the trail be separate. Again, not saying that it needed to have no intrusion within the 15 feet, but that the trail be separate within the 8 feet and modifying landscaping or whatever as required. They probably can both happen within a little more than 8 feet. Certainly they both could happen within 15 feet. I mean, maybe in 14 or 12 they could even happen.
Yeah. I think that's a point well taken. Perhaps this whole thing doesn't have to shift completely 15 feet, but that what has to happen is that I would suggest that you talk to the Conservation Commission and have them provide you with a minimum or their required trailway width so that there's a clear opportunity for a marked trail. And the Conservation Commission is starting to put in trails. And then that would serve as a sound basis in terms of coming back to the Planning Board and saying, and it's clear to the Board that you wanted to minimize the impacts as much as possible. There are some impacts if there's another 2 feet into the wetland. I don't know if there's anyone here that's capable of quantifying the additional impact on that wetland, particularly with the report that we have in terms of its value. And I think that what that'll do is it'll deal with several issues. It'll deal with the abutters a little better, and it'll deal with the Conservation Commission and the Land Trust and provide an opportunity to increase the buffering. So I guess what I would support Janet's concerns, and I think we can resolve Steve's concerns with that, and it also is consistent with the letter that we've received from the Conservation Commission. Again, keeping in mind we have a tabling motion before us and we're discussing that motion. Any other items that the board would like to relay to the applicant? Yes.
Question, and this kind of goes back to this whole item with the property line. We touched on it and we kind of left it for a while. And I guess I'm kind of getting the impression that the direction the board is giving, or at least the majority of the board, is that that issue should be fully resolved before the board will act on this project. And I guess my initial thoughts on that is typically things like that, boundary disputes have become, you know, a private or civil matter between the two owners. You know, obviously there's some other things that the board wants us to look at, and we can do that, but I will have to be honest in saying that a property line dispute between surveyors can be, well, frankly, it can be quite a process, and I'm trying to get a sense from the board. I know that some communities that they leave that as a private or civil matter, and it's very important, I think, to Joel, as far as the direction we go from here, what the consensus of the board is on that issue.
I'll offer my opinion and then let the board offer theirs. I think ultimately it is a civil matter. I think if the board votes to table this, it would be helpful to have some additional information for the next meeting. Ideally, the abutter, if they so choose, could come up with a more thorough discussion of the issue with respect to land area meets and bounds and the other things that describe the property. It seems that I haven't heard anything that the frontages are not consistent or the other lot lines aren't consistent. What's in dispute here only is the common line between the two properties. It would seem that there may be an area described within the two deeds that would indicate that the fluctuation of that line would also imply that the area might change. I don't know if that exists, but what I think as a minimum, what it would do is afford you as the applicant the opportunity to get a letter from the surveyor describing the basis for their assumptions about the delineation of that common property line. I heard the abutters' concerns. I've heard a lot of abutters' concerns on a lot of applications in other towns, there's absolutely no conclusive evidence that the abutters' line is any more accurate than the applicant's line. There's quite a lot of misunderstanding about where property lines truly exist in the face of the earth. So I guess as a minimum, I would ask that you come back with additional information that would give the board some argument about why that line is described the way it is. And again, I understand that your firm has not done the survey work, that what you've done has been given a survey by the applicant that he's gotten from another source. As one member of the board, I certainly, if that dispute continues, while it's not ideal to approve a plan, assuming the plan were approved, with a boundary in dispute. I don't think that we can hold up the applicant for 2 years or more while the two abutters resolve this thing in court. The whole burden is placed on you at that point. There's obviously a cost to the abutter in terms of any legal action necessary, but you're really the one at risk in terms of proceeding with an application if there's a problem with the common property line. So I think the issue will ultimately get resolved to one way or the other, and the best the board can do is ask for whatever reasonable information you can provide to help us understand how the surveyor who's done the plan that's in front of us decided upon that common line. That doesn't seem like too onerous a request. Okay. How do the other board members feel about that? Roy?
Mr. Chair, I have one, maybe a suggestion in a meeting of the minds in a concerns the buffer zone, the 8 feet that was brought up. And maybe it's not possible, but maybe the applicant could provide material to go on the abutter's property to increase that buffer zone. I know that brings into consideration who takes care of it and what have you. But this may be an answer, at least to that particular problem, that, all right, I'll bring in 15 furs or whatever it is, of 10 or 12 feet, and I'll put it on your side of the property, 10 feet in, and somehow alleviate that problem of the buffer zone. Thank you.
I think at this point what the board has heard, at least the applicant's been asked, is to provide additional buffering, and how you accomplish that, I think, is up to you to show us. It seems like quite a task if the abutter is not in mutual agreement with the applicant in terms of the proposal to, unless the abutter states that they're willing to do that. That's not an unreasonable request. It certainly serves the abutter some interest as well. The closer the buffer gets to their property, the more impact it has.
I only bring that up too because the sideline of the abutter's house is quite a distance. I don't know what it might be, 120 feet, 100 feet from side of your house to the applicant's property line.
Yes, about 8
well,
feet.
It's quite a good, it's good, pretty good distance. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, any other comments before we vote on the motion? Okay, and again, this is both for the wetland alteration permit and
the public access waiver.
Okay, all those in favor of tabling it until the next regular meeting of the planning board? All opposed? Passes 3-2.
4-2.
Got to count myself. Thank you very much.
Excuse me. First item of new business this evening is a Heffenrafer subdivision amendment. This item was scheduled for 8 o'clock. We're running about 45 minutes behind schedule.
An hour and 45.
An hour and 45.
Oh, an hour and 45 minutes. Well, doing real well then. I must still be.
I'm glad you're having fun. Huh?
In any event, Maureen, can we have a little background on this, please?
Sure. The Hidden Court subdivision is located directly south of Town Hall, so it's adjacent to this structure. And there were, I think, four lots created. It was originally an estate. One of the lots has been purchased by Peter Heffenrafer and Mallory Marshall. They are trying to restore the original estate. And one of their one of their projects is to take what is known as the Summer Drive. And make it a driveway that they can use for ingress and egress. This drive right now exits right into the middle of the intersection of Route 77 and Old Ocean House Road, and when the Planning Board approved the subdivision, they required that that only be used for egress. There was a concern that people would be trying to get in there and run in front of other traffic. What the applicant tonight is suggesting is that that driveway be realigned in a fashion that would be in compliance with traffic safety standards and allow the driveway to be used as the main entrance to that lot for ingress as well as egress. This just as some background, this has gone to the council because it has some impact on the alignment of some town roads, and the council has forwarded it to the Planning Board for the Planning Board's action.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, before we go any further, I'd just like to state for the record that I served on the Landmarks Board of Directors at the same time that Mallory Marshall did. That's my only contact with her. I don't think that that would be of any, you know, necessary to recuse myself, but I just want to state that on the record.
Also, just for the record, I was the listing broker on the lot that contains the summer driveway when the applicants purchased it. The sale has been completed. I feel as though I'm clear to vote on this, but if the board disagrees, please let me know.
Now, if the board could meet as a group outside, we'd expect you to take us to dinner, but since we can't do that, I know the applicant's landscape architect, but I don't consider that to be a conflict either. I don't see any significant issues there. Thank you, though. Does anyone, by any chance, have a plan of the overall subdivision? Did you happen to bring that with you?
Very tiny one.
Okay.
I can get one if you need it.
Yeah, I think it might be helpful for the discussion. Again, while Maureen's gone, this is it's an amendment to an existing subdivision plan. There's no requirement for a public hearing. Maureen gets back. Steve, if you would just give us a bit of the context of the lot of concern with relation to the overall subdivision, and then the traffic pattern as it exists and as it's proposed.
Yes. I think Maureen has done a good job spelling out exactly why we're here before you this evening. As originally approved, the subdivision had a specific restriction on it about the existing driveway being limited to only egress out of the property. In looking at this with the owners, the desire was to be able to look at that driveway as permanent access, and then take the existing driveway that comes out onto 77
just about opposite the real estate office, and essentially close that and leave that as only an emergency access or a service access for some of the larger vehicles. When we looked at this originally back in December, we concurred with what the planning board had determined earlier, which was that that driveway in its present configuration as shown on this board does pose some safety hazards, particularly for traffic trying to enter from a southbound direction on 77 into this driveway. The way this exists right now, to familiarize yourselves, the large brick gates are set right back in here. The gravel driveway is shown here and splays out and comes in right onto an angle on this intersection. The existing island is this odd-shaped island out between the southbound or eastbound lane going in and the outbound lane of Old Ocean House. And then Fowler Road is showed on the opposite side. And then the other driveway from the stand across the street is shown there, flanging off. So we have a odd-shaped intersection. In looking at this, we retained Bill Bray, a traffic engineer, to help us understand how better to look at the area and determine what the existing circulation problems were. In discussing this with Bill, Bill saw, and we've seen as well, an issue with some people coming down southbound on 77 and turning in that northerly lane, cutting above the island and then connecting. But Bill looked at those other areas and felt that the most appropriate way to deal with this intersection was to try and get the driveway into this lot, the Stone House lot, onto and off of 77 itself. That was really the only safe way to gain access and egress into the lot, was from 77 and not from Old Ocean House Road. Because exiting and entering onto Old Ocean House, you would have in excess of 600 feet of sight distance south and north on Route 77. Then the issue became, if we do that, how do we best redefine the circulation pattern for Old Ocean House to achieve what general highway standards are for separation between driveway and adjoining lot. I think with that, I'll take just a brief break and walk you through the subdivision, if I can.
Yeah, if you would just show us which parcels or parcels are being combined or not combined and what the old circulation was in and out.
In the original subdivision plan, when this was owned by Mr. Davis, he peeled this into four lots. The gatehouse lot, the main lot, which is this one here that comes over to Butts Townland and runs down to the Zeb Cove and then came out around and owned a small piece on the other side of the gatehouse. Lot 3 was an additional parcel that had its access via the Summer Road and was intended to serve a building lot back in here. Peter and Mallory purchased Lot 1 and Lot 3, so they now control the Summer driveway and the other driveway and the house. When this was subdivided, the intent was to use this existing driveway that comes off opposite the real estate office as the main and sole access in and out to the Stone House or Lot 1. And Lot 3 would have to develop a new driveway out onto Old Ocean House. When we looked at our options, we didn't feel that developing that new driveway out to Old Ocean House was appropriate because of the desire to keep this historically correct in the way it rests on the land. What Bill Bray did in looking at this was came up with a schematic plan for a revised circulation that took the Summer driveway and pulled it hard up onto Route 77. So now any traffic entering has the opportunity to come to a rest at the edge of 77, look southbound or northbound, and then enter into the flow of traffic on 77. The key issue here was to maintain separation from Old Ocean House Road. To achieve the distance that's the standard for development of this type of driveway adjacent to a roadway, the edge of Old Ocean House Road needed to be pushed to the south by 6 feet here in the island. and then by approximately 24 feet up where it intersects with 77. So what was done was the old edge of roadway, which is here, and driveway were reconfigured such that the new edge of pavement runs further to the south in the existing pavement, and this pavement would be removed and turned into lawn. The gravel road would be pulled hard to the right or to the north and access out onto 77. And then to accommodate the 20-foot travel lane, the curved island would be narrowed to a rather regular form. In looking at this, then, Bill looked at the traffic circulation and site distance and found that, in fact, we still maintained adequate site distance from Old Ocean House as well as from the driveway, and that Old Ocean House people exiting out onto 77 could see the driveway and vice versa. So we weren't creating undue traffic hazards in that location. When we originally looked at this and came to you in the workshop, we had met with the utility companies and paid the utility companies to do a preliminary engineering study on the existing fiber optic lines. There's about 1,500 fiber optic lines that come over and tie into this pole right in there, as well as a trunk line for the town coming down 77. And we had met and consulted briefly with Roger Gobiel down at MDOT, and Roger Gobiel's comment to us was it really falls within the town's purview because it's not in, it's in an urban compact zone, it doesn't fall in our view. Please discuss it with Bob Malley. So we've taken those steps through looking at this, evaluating the driveway. We've discussed at length in the workshop what some of the issues were with it, and have proceeded with the plans based on this alignment and Bill Bay's recommendation. The one change that's occurred that's reflected on your current plans since the time of our workshop is that New England Telephone wanted a cost, or wanted to assess Peter and Mallory $36,000 for disconnect and reconnect of the fiber optic lines. Mm. So the plans that you have show this same configuration and alignment, but we've pulled it just a tad south of that telephone pole to leave that telephone pole there. Mm. Because as it is, we had discussed with Bob Malley the resetting of the curb on the island and some of the other work associated with this, so we knew we had a reasonably expensive project heading into it, and we didn't want to incur that much cost to achieve the driveway out. Bill Bray has reviewed these plans, and I think you have the benefit of a letter from Bill. We received a memo from T.Y. Lynn yesterday, and I discussed that with Maureen, and the one thing that we could respond to in the memo was the request for a response from Bill Bray relative to whether or not the plans represent, that you're looking at, represent what his schematic plans had shown and his feeling about the safety issues related to it. So we have that in front of you, and I apologize for the lateness of that getting to you. I think those are the substantive issues that run with the proposal. I'm going to wrap up just by saying that I've had the opportunity to go through Fred Morin's memo. He has 12 items on that memo, and I know this board's reluctance to have information passed out to it the evening of a board meeting, and I don't expect you to digest that and review that. I've gone through that memo in great detail. Of those 12 items, there are only two items that I wish to just present to the board as things that I find onerous to this application. Everything that Fred has asked for, we will fully comply with. And that extends as well to the extrapolated comments of Bob Malley, because Bob Malley's comments about the relocation of the culvert and the resetting of the curbing are all appropriate, and those will be done on the final documents. The two issues that I just want to present to the board as issues that are problems for us from T.Y. Lynn's memo are item B2, in which Fred has asked for drainage calculations for the culvert that's out there. The reason I want to bring this to the board's attention is that there's an existing 12-inch collapsed culvert out there that's been carrying the drainage around this corner for, as near as we can tell, about the past 35 years. In the changes that we're making, we are decreasing the amount of impervious area. We're taking out pavement in that watershed, and we're keeping the gravel area just about the same, so the net change on that watershed is a decrease in the runoff going into the culvert. Secondarily, the watershed for that is about 3 acres. It's fairly small, so we really don't have any significant flows. We looked at what we were doing for grades and knew that we had enough clearance to sneak an 18-inch culvert in there, and we're comfortable in terms of drainage and flows that that's going to work. And we've looked that over with Bob Malley, and there's a level of comfort there that doesn't really speak to going through the additional work of drainage calculations. The only other issue that I want to ask the board to consider on this is the specific request from Fred to have the MDOT, to have Roger Gobiel sign off on the appropriateness of these improvements. MDOT does not want to get involved with reviewing something that falls under town jurisdiction. And they've given me comments about its appropriateness, but my discussion with MDOT is they really prefer not to write a memo. So I don't want to have to pursue MDOT for that memo. So if the board is willing to consider this evening, I would only ask that those two items within that checklist from Fred be things that the board might consider waiving, and we will certainly comply with all the rest. My interest in bringing that up is to move this agenda item forward, let us get our drawings complete, get them back to Fred, and have the staff take care of the follow-up on some of these construction details so that we can begin construction within the next 2 or 3 weeks, which is what we think it'll take to get drawings revised, back to staff, back to us. And with that, I'll turn it back to the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Stephen. Did you state your name and address for the record?
Yes. Stephen Moore from Moore and Sheridan, Landscape Architects.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions? Ms. Fritz?
Sure. Just a few things, actually. You've reconfigured the traffic island there and actually produced a 20-foot-wide travel lane. Was that a town standard to produce that? I mean, it seems so less than 20 feet would be sufficient for a one-way travel lane.
What we had done was looked at the existing width of that pavement and carried that pavement width through at 20 feet. Mm-hmm. In addition, Bill Bray checked with Bob Malley on width, checked with Chief McGuldrick, and that also complies with state standards for that type of access, one-way access.
McGuldrick likes 18 feet anyway, so yeah. It does come to a narrower point. That's fine. I mean, that's a reasonably good explanation. We've got the statement from Bill Bray. Anything from Portland Water District regarding the vertical and horizontal distance from their line?
We had presented our plans to the Portland Water District. Ideally, what they wanted to see was the culvert moved at least 5 feet away from their water line. With the relocation into the right-of-way, that horizontal and vertical distance to the Portland Water District line becomes moot, because okay. The Portland Water District line rests back up in this extreme corner, and we'll be pulling the culvert, so the new culvert location will be approximately 12 feet away from the Portland Water District line at its closest point.
Yeah. I was on the site today, and I saw that marker, and I should have realized that if you can move it, I mean, that does...
We are proposing to move it.
A lot of problems. As a matter of fact, I tried to get down in that little gully there, and you said there's a 12-inch collapse. I would have
collapsed.
Told this board tonight that there's no culvert there anyway. So
it's just crushed under there.
It just looks pretty small. The issue with MDOT, I mean, I realize they're telling you that. What I would like to, and I certainly not don't want to hold up this application, but if we can get something from them that simply says this is not within our purview because it's within the town compact area, therefore it should be town review, not to discuss the merits of your application, but do you think they would be willing to send us something simply stating we don't need to look at it?
That I can get.
Okay. That's what I would feel more comfortable with. The last issue that I have is that I believe in our ordinance, we have a requirement that a driveway is 40 feet from an intersection. This doesn't appear to be that far. I mean, basically what this application does is doesn't really reorient that driveway exit that much because you've got that power pole sitting there. And if you're on the site, it's much more obvious that it's really not moving that far, it's simply dropping that new apron, if you will, down and restricting the exiting travel lane of Ocean House Road, old Ocean House Road, which is an improvement, I think, to this intersection. And on that merit, I guess I'm in favor of that. The last thing that I have is that maybe Maureen can clarify that with Bob Malley that, yes, there is a 40-foot requirement, but as this, you know, he's satisfied with the way it.
Yeah, and he wrote a memo, and he doesn't do that too often, so, I mean, he's happy with it.
He didn't mention that, but I know that that's a requirement.
He doesn't have any problem with it. He would just like his curb reset on the island.
Okay.
Steve, you said it had to be 40 feet from an intersection?
Yes.
Can you tell me where the intersection is?
I took the line. If you extend the southerly line of to reorient it, you can see my drawing if you like. That's just how I.
Okay, took the center line. All right.
It comes up short, but I think it's enough of an improvement on this intersection that it's a good compromise.
That was the context in which we discussed with Bob that we were achieving somewhere between 35 feet to about 38 feet of separation between drive and pavement.
Any other questions or comments?
I just have one comment.
Mr. Carlson? Mr.
Chairman. Are there any plans to protect that telephone pole as far as any pieces of heavy steel?
Yes, NET is requiring us to install two bollards just on the driveway side of the pole because there's steel-encased conduit that feeds up there. Hmm. They feel needs additional protection.
Because coming down into that driveway, I could see something happening, and that pole could be protected as much as possible. Thank you.
Any other comments or questions? I have just a couple of questions. The configuration appears to serve two purposes in terms of the Heffenreffer's use of the property. If they're heading southbound on Route 77, the left turn into the driveway is fairly easy. And if they're exiting the driveway and heading northbound on Route 77, that's pretty easy, and even perhaps a left turn isn't too bad. But obviously the alignment of the driveway is pretty much toward the right. And as you come to the driveway in Route 77, not far from the intersection, your car is going to be angled slightly. This is a classic MDOT intersection that, let me think of where, they're all over the place, but you know what happens, your car is angled, maybe Route 88 and Route 1 in Falmouth has this situation, but you're angled in one direction and you've got to look back over your shoulder. And that's not always the most comfortable situation, and it being that close to the intersection, there's not much time between someone looking, heading on Old Ocean House Road, being stopped at the intersection, looking south on 77, and then darting out, trying to miss traffic northbound on 77, and having someone coming out of the driveway at the same time. I don't think it's an ideal situation, but it's probably an improvement over what's there now. There was some concern raised by the engineer about right turn maneuvers into the driveway. How has that been resolved with either the fire chief or with the town's engineer? Or with the applicant, as far as that's concerned. If the applicant's headed northbound, that's really a pretty severe right turn on a narrow driveway to get in there.
Well, I think in terms of that radius, my brief discussion with Chief McGuldrick originally was that most of his response will be coming southbound on 77 and turning in. We had intentionally kept that radius sharp, trying to keep that distance from Old Ocean House as much as we could, as great a distance as we could. I think what's going to happen based on my review of this with Bill Bray this morning is that 6-foot radius on the southbound side of that driveway is going to be eased out to about a 12-foot radius. if that makes sense to you. So that southern radius will be eased and widen that throat accordingly by about 4 feet at the road edge.
Okay. The other concern that the engineer raised, and you know, quite honestly, I think you recognize this, that the materials that the board has before it are really schematic drawings, that there's nothing that pins this on the face of the earth. I don't know what these plans were laid over to develop, whether it was an MDOT intersection plan or I know the town center survey, for example, the rights-of-way line and the property lines on that are very quite widely or wildly with actual surveys of particular lots. So I think it's a pretty enormous leap from this up to what you'd be submitting to, or I'm assuming what you're going to submit in terms of an engineered plan or a layout plan that can be built in the field. What's your intention in terms of submitting a final drawing to the town's staff and engineer?
Owen Haskell, Inc. went out and did the existing conditions survey. So we are confident in terms of base data with respect to pole locations, topography, culverts, utilities, and rights-of-way. We did use an overlay system to develop those schematic plans. The intent is, if the board is comfortable approving this evening, we'll go ahead and develop a fully detailed set of plans, just as Fred has specified, with appropriate layout, grading, drainage, utility, demolition, erosion controls, and information like that.
Okay. I guess, you know, with the issue of the 12-foot radius versus 6-foot radius, the board can certainly refer this to staff for final review. It's not a real big application, but I would suggest that if there's any major differences because of the actual final layout and what we're seeing here in a schematic form, that it would come back to the board. And at least I would have a discussion with Maureen with respect to when she gets the final drawings to have a review of them. And then if there's any substantive issues, we may ask you to come back.
I'm fine with that. If the board wants to go through that procedure, I would appreciate it because it'll allow us then to continue and develop.
It's really an issue, Steve, that the board has an understanding of what it's reviewing and approving, and that we would expect that when we drive by there after the plans are submitted and it's constructed, that it's what was approved. And unless we have the final drawings in front of us, we don't know that. Yes, Steve.
Are the applicants willing to extend that radius? From experience, we know that Fred, and he follows his own standards, does not take into account any other lanes other than the northbound lane.
Yeah, doesn't take the short.
We have an enormous intersection there to pull a 60-foot rig or 45-foot rig out there. It has to get in there. There's all kinds of room to pull a vehicle in there without shortening that up. There's a compromise to allow this here, and that we're getting it as far away from that intersection as possible. I realize that displaying that opening a lot doesn't change that a great deal, but I also don't see a real need to extend that radius a great deal.
I wouldn't encourage the radius to be any more than is necessary to get the vehicles that are intended to use that driveway in and out on a regular basis. The planning board likes narrow driveway openings. I wouldn't want the applicant to be unrealistic in terms of how small that radius could be with creating a real inconvenience to the users of the property. And, you know, when they become not only short radiuses but acute angles, then that gets a little tough sometimes. Any other questions or comments? Okay. Do I have a motion? Mr. Edsel?
I have a motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Peter Heffenreffer and Mallory Marshall are requesting amendment to the Hidden Court subdivision that would realign the summer driveway, in quotes, to make it the main entrance. Number two, realignment of a driveway on Route 77 in close proximity to Old Ocean House Road requires careful consideration of altered traffic patterns and drainage system. Number three, the amendment substantially complies with the standards of subdivision ordinance section 16.3.11. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Peter Heffenreffer and Mallory Marshall for an amendment to the Hidden Court subdivision that would realign the summer driveway be approved.
In number three, I think you meant to say 16-3-1.
What if I said the wrong number, then? We'll change it to 16-3-1.
Okay. Any conditions that you want to place with that motion? Well, let me back up again. We have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
We probably should discuss Bob Melly's request to reset all the granite curving around the island. I'm not an engineer, and I'm not a project, or I'm not a builder. I don't know how you do one side and not the other and have it look right. Maybe that could be explained to me.
No, we've agreed to do that. Yeah. We've agreed to reset the curb around the entire island.
Fine. That's the only thing I could think of.
I think we only need to add conditions if there's something that's unclear, I think. I think there's a certain level of trust here that that there's currently about 4 inches of exposure of that big granite. Applicant says they're going to lift that anyway.
Yeah, why don't we just wait a minute until they get the recorder back on?
I was getting nervous there.
Particularly in the middle of a motion.
No record of this.
Time for a little Jeopardy theme music.
What was the question?
No, there's an answer.
That's it.
I could review with the board how thankful I was that this didn't include any wetlands alterations or public access waivers.
There may be a drainage gully alteration permit that popped
or up. Easements.
Yeah.
So the boundary looks like it may be disputed. That's all.
Where would the largest wetland alteration permit granted for 5,000 is pretty bad. I'd be curious, actually.
We're ready. Who is
all set? Okay, we have a motion and it's been seconded. And did you get the motion, Alice?
I've got it.
Okay. Any discussion, further discussion on the motion? Mr. Parkhurst had mentioned. You had a question about the island, and that's already part of the application, so that doesn't have to amend the motion. But the applicant has already agreed to reconfigure the entire island or to reset all of the curbing on the island. I guess I would offer two other ones, that the final plans be submitted and approved by town staff and the planning board chair before beginning construction, and that the application provide a letter from or to the Department of Transportation with respect to any concerns with the proposed improvements. What I mean by that is if the Department of Transportation isn't going to send you a letter, they aren't going to send you a letter. And if they don't elect to do that, then your only recourse is to send them a letter stating your understanding. And presumably, if it's not consistent with their understanding, they'll let you know in writing. That doesn't hold up in court, by the way, does it? No, I didn't think
but
so.
But it's some some indication of good faith.
Anyway. Yeah. Maureen?
Is it the board's intent that, I mean, I think the applicant has agreed to comply with all but one section of the town engineer's letter.
Yes.
And comply with all of the memo that the public works director has recommended. And I guess I would feel more comfortable if that was an actual condition that the applicant comply with the requirements of the town engineer's letter with the exception of item B2, and even the request from MDOT has been clarified as to what the content of that letter needs to be. So,
correct.
I think that's appropriate.
I think that might be a little bit clearer. I know the applicant has agreed to do it.
Okay, I think item B2 should be amended to say that that the size of the culvert will be as approved by the Public Works Director.
That's fine.
That's fine.
All right.
Those are acceptable conditions. It's fine for my second as well.
Okay. So, all right, what do we have here? Do we have three?
Two conditions.
Two conditions. One is that it's consistent with the town engineers, with the exception of B2, and secondly, that the final plans are submitted. To staff.
Mm-hmm.
Approved. Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Last item under new business is the Williams site plan, a request by Ogden Williams for site plan review for a home school to be located at 5 Beach Bluff Terrace, section 19210, site plan completeness. Maureen, a little background?
Certainly. Mr. Williams went to the zoning board for the approval of a home school. It's called the Beach Bluff School. It's located at the corner of Beach Bluff Terrace and Shore Road. Because it's a conditional use, he went to the zoning board in June, got an approval for 1 year with several conditions, which are included in here. He's now coming to the planning board because site plan approval is also required. What you have before you is a summary of completeness. I have included in the memo a completeness checklist, and I have not myself determined that any items are missing. There are some items that are requesting a waiver, and they, from my review, they all seem to be acceptable based on what the applicant is proposing. Right now, he's not proposing to make any exterior changes to the site at all. So it would basically be a review of the use and whether some exterior changes do need to be made. The town engineer's letter is also attached. He has primarily mentioned a concern about looking at the site distance for Beach Bluff Terrace, since there will be additional traffic of children being picked up and dropped off. Are there any questions?
None from me. Anyone else? Mr. Edsel.
What's our triple witching hour? Is it 10 o'clock? I think just a formality we have to agree to.
Is it 10? It's not 11, huh? Okay.
No.
But just formality, I think we have to send a vote to continue.
Yeah. All those in favor of continuing the new business after 10 o'clock, indicate by raising your hand. We'll continue. I'm an hour behind. I don't know why. I'm just him. Thank you, Steve. Again, this did receive conditional use approval with several conditions. With that, please introduce yourself and provide a brief presentation.
Thank you. My name is Ogden Williams. I live at 5 Beach Bluff Terrace. I'm a school teacher. If you were my class, I'd have you do some jumping jacks now and give you a 15-minute recess, but we better press on here. For the past 6 years, I've taught third grade at Pond Cove School. Several months ago, I applied for and received a one-year leave of absence. My wife and I are asking permission to use our home to teach six children in addition to our own two. Since we're taking on other children, the responsibility of education of other children besides our own, what we're doing is officially designated a school by the state, so therefore we're asking your approval. Our proposal indicates nothing negative about town schools or about public schools in general. The seed of why we're doing this is simply that I wanted a chance to teach my own two children for 1 year and also to experiment with different ideas I've had about teaching in a small home-based environment. Last month, we received permission from the zoning board with the conditions that you've heard about. Our home is situated on half an acre of land. I've sort of outlined it here. It's on the corner of Shore Road and Beach Bluff Terrace, which is a dead-end street. It's separated from Shore Road by a stone wall, and there are hedges forming a boundary all along Beach Bluff Terrace. There's also shrubbery and trees outlining the rest of our property. The children in our school will all be 8 years old or older. There are 59 neighbors on the town mailing list to receive official notices about this proposal. These are the neighbors within 500 feet of our property. My wife and I sent letters to each of these 59 people explaining the details of what we're trying to do, and I've personally tried to speak with all 59 of them. I've been able to contact 50 of them. Of those 50 people, I spoke with five who were opposed. One I didn't actually speak to. He lives in Scarborough, but he sent a letter to the town hall. The other 45 neighbors that I spoke to all stated that they have no objection to what we're trying to do or were directly in favor of it. I've submitted copies of letters from 13 neighbors stating their support or lack of opposition to the proposal. I believe there are also additional letters and statements of oral support on file at the town hall. In going over what the town engineer commented about a proposal, he did express concern that if all three cars in the carpool arrived at our driveway at the same time, it would force one of them to park or at least stop on the side of the street. Our intent is to have this not happen. I want to first note that three is the maximum number of cars which would be making drop-offs. I actually believe the number will be more like two cars. However, it is possible that it's three. I haven't gotten the official carpool report back from the parents. But I do believe that it's possible, given the fact that this pickup and drop-off will be occurring in a 15-minute time period, that we can stagger the cars so that they don't all, by design, they don't all arrive at the same time. And I think that by just using some human ingenuity and thinking about it, we can come up with a plan where that type of situation will not arise. If it did, there are other things we could do. We could always have the kids dropped off, say, at or some of them at perhaps a public place such as the parking lot of Thomas Memorial Library, and we could pick them up and drive them over. But I seriously think that it's possible to arrange these three cars in such a way that that would not happen. Excuse me. The engineer also have suggested we have the driveway surveyed for site distances, since there is the map shows bushes on both sides of our driveway. I would like to point out that I asked a professional surveyor how much it would cost to have that site plan, that site done. It would cost me $350. Although I understand there's a fellow in the police department who might do it. But anyway, I'm hoping that I will not be required to do that. We've safely entered and exited our driveway for 4 years without feeling that it was a dangerous situation. We can see cars on both distances. I should point out that the hedges all along here, I planted all of these myself. All the hedges within about 40 feet of the driveway, I purposely picked low-growing shrubbery. I forget the name of it. It's very attractive to Japanese beetles, I can tell you that much. But they're all within 3.5 feet tall or less, and they can be clipped down as low as anybody wants them to be. On the other side, this tree is a formidable looking object, but I should point out that the only obstruction caused by that tree is actually the trunk. All of the high growing foliage is up in the air, and that also that corner affords a much better distance for looking, seeing what's going on as you pull out than it would appear from that large mass labeled a tree. I believe Mrs. O'Meara has copies of some photographs showing our driveway area. Also, the engineer's report suggests frequent monitoring of the septic system for signs of malfunction. We'd be happy to comply with that, provided it can be done at a reasonable expense. I should point out that the proposal, our proposal, will have no effect on bathing or laundering or dishwashing. The total impact on sewage disposal will be, or water, will be additional 6 children during weekday school hours only, using the bathrooms, using low-volume water conservation fixtures we've already have installed in our home. We're committed to pursuing this activity in such a way so that we serve not only the six Cape Elizabeth youngsters, but we do it in such a way that we do not inconvenience our surrounding neighborhood or the community as a whole. We hope the board will act favorably on our request for site plan approval subject to reasonable qualifications. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any of the board members have any questions for the applicant? We have a motion on the completeness part of the application. Mr. Hudson.
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Ogden and Peggy Williams for site plan review of a proposed homeschool for 8 children located at 5 Beach Bluff Terrace be deemed complete.
Second.
Second.
Any further discussion on the motion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. The second item that needs to be dealt with is the public hearing. The item is not required to go to public hearing. It's a site plan review. It did have a public hearing at the zoning board. So I guess what I would do is ask if anyone has a motion with respect to a public hearing. Mr. Edsel.
It would be my recommendation that we not hold a public hearing, but I'm not sure that we have to make a motion because it's not required.
Perhaps this is a way of determining what the board's preferences are. I also feel that no public hearing would be necessary. It seems as though the...
I don't mind making a motion.
Why don't you go ahead and then we can use it as a basis of discussion.
A motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that the application of Ogden and Peggy Williams for site plan review...
No, that won't work.
Yeah. That won't work.
Well,
then we'll just not do it.
Well, let's use a straw vote. I think it's worth the time to discuss it because it is a public, very public project. Any concerns with respect to having or not having a public hearing? All those in favor of having a public hearing?
All those in favor.
Let me state this: the Planning Board, as much as possible, seeks public input. I think we have a very good record of the public concerns in the Zoning Board review. Although tonight's meeting is not scheduled as a public hearing, certainly if there were a lot of concerned abutters, I would expect to see them here showing a presence that would encourage us to support a public hearing. I think the issues that are substantive to this application rest with the use, not with the site plan review, that there are no proposed alterations. And what we're really talking about is a family that was only two children larger than my family and that I grew up in a house that was much larger and a site that was about the same size. So I can't get, for a 1 year, again, it's a conditional use permit that expires within 1 year, and if there's any substantive impact that isn't immediately evident, then it would have to come back before the Zoning Board and to the Planning Board once again. So I again would support, I don't see any need for having a public hearing. Okay, so no need for a motion on that. Any further questions with respect to any site plan issues or site distances? Does anyone have any, Mr. Edsel?
Actually, I was just going to sort of preempt that, and I'd like to make a motion.
Certainly, go ahead.
Okay, motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, number one, Ogden and Peggy Williams are requesting a site plan review of a proposed homeschool for 8 children located at 5 Beach Bluff Terrace. Number two, the Zoning Board of Appeals granted conditional use approval on June 27, 1995. Number three, the application substantially complies with the requirements of site plan review section 19-2-10. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Ogden and Peggy Williams for site plan review of a proposed homeschool for 8 children located at 5 Beach Bluff Terrace be approved.
Second.
Second. Any further discussion?
I'd just like to commend Mr. Williams for his thoroughness in preparing the materials that are before us. It really was a pleasure to review them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's clear that he'll be teaching planning.
I've learned a lot.
Not all of which you intended to learn, right?
Have a motion, have a second. All those in favor indicate by raising right hand. Passes unanimously. You have your
Thank pool. You very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That is the last item of new business. Is there any other discussions? Seeing none. A motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Meeting's adjourned.